Hello, I'm Matthew Turner from Enduring Domain Architecture. Welcome to my next video. Today I want to talk about something which is probably one of the most important considerations when designing an energy efficient, environmentally sustainable building, whatever you want to call it, and that is the sun. Letting the sun into your building at the right time and being able to exclude it from your building at the right time. So the act of controlled entry of sun into our buildings is often referred to as solar gain or passive solar gain. And probably the best analogy to help understand how solar gain works is that of a greenhouse, the greenhouse effect. So anyone who's ever been into a greenhouse, which is basically a building made of glass to grow plants in, that's a very warm environment and it's creating a microclimate for those plants to grow and to thrive. So whenever the sun is out and you're in a building with a lot of glass, you're gonna feel that warmth, especially if you're directly within that sun directly coming on you. Anyone who's ever been into a greenhouse at night will also know that it's very cold, and that's because that glass just cannot retain the heat that's been generated during the day. So all that heat which has been created isn't able to be retained within that structure, and it's passing through that glass back to the outside, which is the colder environment. So heat always moves to a colder side of a surface, basically. So in order to design good passive solar buildings, which do take advantage of the free heat energy from the sun, of course, during the colder months, but we also want to exclude that sun in the hotter months from our buildings, we need to get a good understanding of where the sun is in the sky. How does it move across the sky? How does that relate to a building, a solid wall or a window or a shading device? So I'm going to go back on a little journey of humans' discovery of sun and shade. Starting with this image. Now, any self-respecting movie buff out there would recognize this scene. Of course, from 2001, A Space Odyssey. This is one of the opening scenes called The Dawn of Man, where a very regular shaped monolith suddenly appears in the landscape. And this scene is depicted in the Paleolithic era, roughly 2.5 million years ago. So just to give you a bit of context, there's all the ape-like hominid, early humans, if you like, wondering what the hell is this thing? But surely something like that, especially with the sun rising over the top of it, is going to cast some serious shade. And not unlike an Egyptian obelisk, a very tall needle-like stone monument, which would be acting a lot like a sundial, casting shadow on the ground. People would definitely notice that shadow moving along the ground as the day progresses. And it wouldn't be too hard to put two and two together to realize that movement of the shadow is caused by the sun moving across the sky. This is what that monolith might look like today with the venerated touchscreen. that we're all staring at. Moving a bit further ahead in history, this is of course Stonehenge in the south of England, constructed over a period of many years from 3000 to 1500 BC, spanning the Neolithic and Bronze Age eras. Now there's much debate and speculation about what was the purpose of Stonehenge and other such circular stone structures around the UK. But it has been noted that there are certain stones which align with the setting sun at the winter solstice and at the summer solstice. So shortest day of the year and the longest day of the year. So it is assumed that that this formation has some kind of relation to the position of the sun at various times of the year. And obviously you can see the shadow being cast there on the ground. When the sun does shine in England, that's going to be something very noticeable and very likely that the stones were arranged in a very deliberate manner to cause shade and sun on the ground at different times of the year. This is one of the earliest known sundials found in Egypt, in the Valley of the Kings. It's said to date back to the 13th century BC. So that small hole, you can imagine there would have been some kind of upright piece in there, which would have cast shadow onto the markings on that piece of stone, which would have indicated the time of day. Now, how does that relate to building? So jumping ahead, this is some fairly traditional vernacular architecture, if you like, from the Kathmandu Valley in Nepal. So the Kathmandu Valley, you might say, has a similar climate to Melbourne or to central Victoria, where fairly mild, warm summers, cool to cold winters. So this is a style of building which has developed over many years, I guess, from trial and error to see what works the best. And obviously back then they didn't have any electric or gas, you know, heating or cooling systems. So their buildings had to do all that work for them. You can see that there's quite a modest amount of openings in these buildings, so a number of smaller windows. We don't have huge areas of glass or fenestration or openings. They're all quite modest in size, and there's also some degree of control as to what comes in through those windows. So we see these big overhanging verandas. No doubt they're providing weather protection to the walls themselves. They might have been made out of mud door or stone with an earthen mortar. So obviously protection of the building fabric from the weather is very important, but also the sun being able to exclude that high angle summer sun from those windows. So it looks like they've found the right balance between solid wall and openings. So to be letting that sun in when there is sun, but also to have enough solid wall to be able to retain the heat that they do produce, to have that cozy internal environment. Okay, so jumping ahead, these do look like older buildings, but this was actually designed and built mid-last century, designed by an architect who was a bit of an early inspiration of mine. His name was Hassan Fathi, an Egyptian architect. And he was notably responsible for reviving a traditional method of earthen building in a region of Egypt where building load-bearing mud brick or adobe walls and also vaulted roofs without any formwork, so not a lot of timber available. Traditionally in Egypt, being a bit of a desert country, obviously. So using the one resource they had plenty of, which was mud, and developing building techniques where they can not only build walls and roofs out of that material, but using it in such a way which is going to respond to the specific needs of their climate. We can see a lot of deep shade being cast here. Some small openings just under these vaults, which would let in some ventilation and some cooling breezes. And fairly typically, these buildings would be very tightly grouped together, having a very minimal exposure, wall surface air exposure to the sun. And they could be opening up to a courtyard, which is very shaded. There might be some bigger openings opening up to the courtyard, whereby the smaller openings facing the street would induce air movement from a small opening out through the larger openings towards the back in the courtyard. The courtyard would also have a water feature, a pond, and that moisture would also help to cool that microclimate around the building with moving air passing over that water. Now, jumping ahead, I tell a lie, this building here actually came 20 years before the Egyptian mud building I just showed you. At the time, this was deemed the pinnacle of modern architecture. So this is Philip Johnson's glass house, no doubt inspired by Mies van der Rohe's Farnsworth house. Mies van der Rohe, of course, being the famous modernist German architect. Philip Johnson was sort of like the American counterpart. And this was a much lauded, much awarded building, depicting the height of the modernist architecture movement mid last century. Undoubtedly, this would have been single glazing. All the black stuff is steel. And then we have a continuous masonry circular structure penetrating from the inside of the building through the roof to the outside. Did I mention that this is a house? Yeah, so that was designed for someone to live in. That cylindrical masonry structure would house the bathroom and anything which needed to be private, but all the rest of it, as you can see, is very, very open, very transparent. The white stuff you see on the trees and on the ground, that's snow. Now, snow, I don't have a lot of experience with, but I'm told it's quite cold. Now, if you have a structure with an exposed steel frame, a thermal breach by the way of brickwork penetrating through your building from inside to outside, and a hell of a lot of single glazed glass, that building is going to be, I would say, quite cold at this time of the year. I would say there's a lot of condensation running down the inside of that glass, as we saw in my video, my previous video, what happens when it's cold outside and you have poorly insulated glazing. Okay, if you do get some sun during the day, you might get some solar gain in there heating it up. But the middle of winter, you might only have 4 or 5 usable hours of solar gain, followed by 19 or 20 hours of dark, cold, no sun to heat the building, and basically you're fighting a losing battle to retain heat within your building. What's next? Okay, so Facebook, love it or hate it, we all are exposed to it to some degree. I'm on a few forums. Yeah, some of them are a bit of a time waster. And I think there's a lot of public discussion groups out there where people are seeking really important information about house design, house building. I'm going to say Facebook is not online university. Okay. Facebook is not online university. So a lot of opinions, a lot of information being thrown about on some of these discussion groups. I think it's very hard for the average person to make heads or tails of it all or know what's good and what's bad. But this is an image of someone's house I found on one of these groups. So I'm not going to name, you know, I'm not interested in who designed it, who built it, whose house it is or whatever. I'm going to say that's a lot of glass and that's a very big building. Those two things alone, I'm doubting how energy efficient a building like that really is. Okay, so I'm assuming that's the north facade of the building where most mildly educated people are going to put most of their glass. We do have a roof overhang to some extent, but also that north wall and the height of the glass is very tall. So the taller the glass from ground to the top, the deeper your roof overhang needs to be so that in the height of summer and even a little bit beyond, that roof overhang is sufficiently shading your glass. Now, I can just use a little tool here. Okay, so we're talking about, you know, this depth of roof overhang up here, and the shade really wants to be coming down, so it's not coming up through the bottom of those windows. So that's in the peak of summer, but even, you know, looking at late February, early March, it can still be quite hot. So then the sun gets lower in the sky, starts to come underneath our roof overhang, and then it's hitting our glass. If you notice also these windows, it's like four feature windows across the front here that seem to be protruding from the building envelope. And maybe that's to give the impression of a deep, thick wall internally or something like that. That's creating additional surface area of your building. So the more surface area you have, that's the more opportunity for heat loss. And it's more difficult to insulate and weather seal all of those junctions. You know, it's one thing to do it on a drawing, but it's another thing to actually have that executed on the building site. And also, you know, we've got these two very separate looking pavilions with a gap in the middle. So maybe they're linked across here that we can't see in that image. But again, that's increasing the surface area of the building. You can't have, you know, a centralized heating system. There's got to be something separate in each of those pavilions. So more energy being used to heat a larger building with unnecessarily complex large surface area, in my opinion. Okay. So this is a row of townhouses, which is very, very typical. We see them everywhere. And they face the street, but the street could be facing any direction. This one happens to be facing east. I'm going to say that's a lot of glass in a lot of small windows. You know, maybe these two windows here are part of one room. I would say if you want to have that much glass, just have one window twice the size. It's going to be a lot cheaper than having two separate smaller windows like that. The other thing is, there's absolutely no shading whatsoever on those windows. So the sun rises in the east. That's something early humans would have understood. So the sun is very low when it rises in the east. It's coming in horizontally into all of those windows. There's nothing to stop that sun coming in. Summer, that's going to be hot. Winter, that's going to be great. But also, given that this is facing the street, there's no privacy. So what ends up happening is people just keep their blinds shut. As you can see, in most of these windows, the blinds are shut. There's also no solar access because the northern sun would be coming from this direction. It's hitting the top of your parapet. Okay, there's a little gap here. If there was a window on that side, I'm doubting it's of any significance or facing the living area, but anything on this lower story would be completely shaded by this building next to it. The two here join with the party wall. There's no solar gain whatsoever, usable solar gain coming into this building here on the left. Okay, what's next? Okay, let's stop that. If I can demonstrate on a SketchUp model here a little bit more about how sun comes into our buildings. This is a form that you see very typically these days. Let's call it a modern farmhouse vernacular. So, you know, people like this kind of silhouette. Maybe it's a bit of a more steeply pitched roof, but it doesn't have any eaves. It's got these very minimal flashings at the wall and the roof junction. It's like a clean box all around. People love that at the moment. I'm going to call it a trend. Okay, let's have a look at the sun. What I have to do, so just have to reduce the opacity of my glass so I can see that sun coming in. Now this is midday in January. If I go to this view here, I can see that sun coming into my building, which we don't want because that's going to be heating up the inside of our building. It's 35 degrees outside and you've got sun coming in, sooner or later the inside of your building is going to warm up as well with nothing to stop it. I've just shown a variety of different window sizes here just to show the effect that the height of the window has. So obviously the window which goes down to floor level is letting in the most. Then we have a sill about 500 mils above floor level, and then a sill about a metre above floor level. So obviously the sill that's higher is letting in less glass, less light. So that's less bad. Okay. What happens in the morning? Nothing to stop sun coming into that east window at all. Luckily, you've only got one small window there. What happens on the west in the afternoon? I've got a big window there. Maybe you've got an awesome view out to the west. So of course, that's where you're going to put a big window. Sun coming all the way in, unobstructed, heating your building. That's when people end up just dropping the blinds and they don't have the view or the light anyway. Let's have a look at an alternative to that clean, modern barnhouse vernacular typology. Simply going to put an eave overhang. The beauty of having a pitched roof, all you need to do to control the sun is to extend the top cord of your truss or rafter. In this case, I've got a 600 mil overhang. My ceiling height is 2.7 meters. My window head height is 2.4. So on the north, I always like to have a bit of a taller head heights for my windows to let a bit of winter sun deeper into the building. Any other facade of the building, I can drop that to 2.1 to have a bit more of a modest area of glass. Okay, let's look at the middle of winter, the middle of the day. That sun is coming deep into the building. So all the head heights are the same. So they're all coming back the same depth into that room. But you'll see with the varying sill heights that the extent of the sun coming in is different. So that high sill obviously doesn't let in as much of an area of the sun. So what we're trying to do is find that balance of this roof overhang. So if I go back to summer, the sun is totally excluded in all instances. But then in late February, that can still be quite a warm time of the year, getting some hot days. My tall window here, I'm getting sun in, and that's probably still too much for that time of the year. So I can do two things. I can raise the sill of my window, or I can extend that roof overhang. It's about finding the balance between the two, depending on what you're trying to achieve with your design. Let's look at the west. All I've done here is put out an awning. East and west side of the building is a great place to put a covered outdoor area. So we're not getting any sun. Okay, sorry. Let's go to the middle of summer. That's the middle of the day. That's completely in the shade until 5 p.m. We're not getting sun into that western window until after 5 o'clock. And then, yes, it does start to come low and then comes into our building. Let's see what happens if I didn't have that awning. If I just hide that, the sun's coming in much deeper. So that's something. Another option you have there is to drop blinds down on this edge of the roof overhang. So at least you can still sit outside, have a bit of a view, and be blocking that sun from coming into your building. Here's another classic modern kind of form, the skillion, with an upwards pointing skillion. So there is a temptation to try and have more taller glass on your north to let that sun further back into the building. But as I discussed in that previous image, you need to get the length of this roof overhang right. So in summer, the middle of the day, yes, that overhang is enough to be shading all of that glass. As soon as I go to February, it starts to come into our building. So that's the end of February. That's getting quite a bit of sun in there. So that's when we need to start looking at the length of our overhang. So sure, you can do that, but that adds some structural complexity. Having a cantilever, I know that's every architect's wet dream, to have the biggest physics-defying cantilever they can. But trust me, you're spending a lot of money to hide structure in there, which isn't necessarily a good place to spend your money. So you can see that I've extended that overhang. I'm still getting some sun coming in. Although in the middle of winter, sure, you're getting sun deep back into that room, but the trade-off is we've created a taller volume in here. You know, we've got this raking ceiling, so we've got all of this extra space that we need to heat. And of course, anything over 2 meters is over your head. So you try and heat space which your body's not even occupying. You have to flood all of this upper level of your volume with heat before that heat is going to start to come down to the human occupant level. So, you know, there's some trade-offs in order to get that kind of form. The other thing to keep in mind is the direction of north. So we have three different kinds of north. We have magnetic north, we have grid north, and we have true north or solar north. Magnetic north is the north that you find when you get out a compass. So a compass will point towards magnetic north. That is not necessarily the same as the North Pole. And depending on where you are, on the planet, true north or solar north, which is the direction towards the North Pole, is going to have some degree of difference from magnetic north. So grid north is what you typically get on a survey drawing or a plan title that's that you get for your block of land. It'll have a north arrow on there. So you know, it's not always the case, but usually that's based on, in Australia, the MGA standard, the Map Grid of Australia. That's actually not too far off true north or solar north. There was just another image I wanted to show you that demonstrates. Forget about it, I can't find that image. But in Melbourne, true north is roughly 10 degrees to the west of magnetic north. So if we're talking about an ideal orientation for solar gain in our buildings, you know, the direction to face glass for your living areas, that's going to be true north or solar north. You can actually get good results still by the side of true north. So if there's some constraints with your site or review or the contours of your land, you can't get that exact solar north orientation, you still might be, you know, 20 degrees or so either side of solar north, and the principles that I just showed you would still work. So what we want to do is to be able to have fixed shading. The simplest way to do that is the roof overhang, which is going to both let in that low angle sun in the cooler months and exclude that higher angle sun. There's no moving parts. We don't need to like pull out the sail shade that's like tied to big posts outside and, you know, rig it all up and, you know, get around to taking it down when summer's over. You know, you don't need to do anything like that if you're planning your building out well. So the biggest challenge is the windows on the east or the west. Of course, there's always going to be the view that people want to have out in those directions, but the view is always going to be there. You walk outside your building, the view is there. You can have a small, modest, framed snapshot of that view, which is in the right place, so that where you put your couch, you can look out of that view. It doesn't need to be a wall of glass to appreciate that view. And if it means that you are going to be more comfortable throughout the year, have cheaper heating and cooling bills, but still be able to enjoy that view to a degree, then I think that's the way to go. There's a bit of a Zen philosophy on views, that having a view presented to you there all the time, you inevitably will take that for granted before too long. But if you have a small snapshot of a view that you're framing, a certain part of that view that you might just get a glimpse of walking down a passageway, that's a little snapshot you get in your mind, and that's something interesting and appealing that you only get a glimpse of whenever you walk past that window on the way to somewhere else, and you never get sick of that experience. But then, of course, when you want to experience that whole thing, you can just go outside. You know, maybe you have to wait for a nice day, or maybe you don't care about that. You know, like maybe you just want to sit outside. Maybe you've got a bit of a covered area, so if there's a bit of a wind or a bit of rain, like that's fine. You can just go out there and enjoy the view. Other than that, come inside, be comforted by your home, which has the right balance of glass to solid wall, and you're always going to be warm, and you can enjoy the sun and the view, whatever you have, at a stable temperature all the time. So that's a little bit of 101 on daylighting and solar gain. And there'll be another topic that we'll have a bit of an introduction to in the next video. All right, see you next time.